Dear attendees, welcome again to the second part of keynote session. So first, I would like to introduce you our third speaker, Dr. Ashfaq Abbas Abul. She completed her PhD degree in clinical pharmacy and currently an assistant professor at Süleymaniye University, Iraq. Doctor has many scientific publications on clinical pharmacy, and today's speech will be in a way that combines her field of expertise with COVID-19 topics. Doctor, we have 15 minutes for your speech.
Yes.
And we are ready.
Hello, everybody. Assalamu alaikum. Thank you all for attending the conference. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Aptos University for trying hospitality. Thank you, I am Sibiru. We will talk about how to build the immune system and defense system better than manage COVID-19. How valuable are a new practitioner and COVID-19? Yes. Content of the structure. Role of nutraceutical and the management of COVID-19 cases, vitamins and minerals, and acetylcysteine, drugs extracted from herbal origin. COVID-19 at a glance. We have to review some things about COVID-19, its definition, pathology, and symptoms and signs, course and complication. We will be inheriting on this subject. First of all, human, we have 7 human coronaviruses, 4 normal and 3 novel. The order is nidovirales, the family coronaviridae and ronaviridae, arteriviridae. What we interested is a coronavirus. This is a family. The subfamily is coronavirina and toravirina. Again, we interested in coronavirina, which include some genus, alpha coronavirus, beta coronavirus, and gamma coronavirus. So we have a look on this. This is coronavirus structure, and we all is familiar with it. Medium-sized virus size, but largest messenger RNA genome, envelope positive trans RNA, messenger RNA encased in nucleoperside, lipid bilayer, so fork to disrupt this. So this is very important. Corona is a crown for spikes, glycoprotein spikes, peptomere spikes allow it to attach to a human cell receptors in upper or lower airways. This is a statistics about the infections and mortality, the mortality in corona in Middle East. Novel coronaviruses, predominantly in lower respiratory tract, SARS, MERS, SARS-CoV-2. Don't forget others like viral pneumonia, influenza, adenovirus, para-influenza, respiratory syncytial virus, human metapneumovirus, typical bacterial cap, lobar streptococcus pneumonia, staphylococcus aureus, hemophilus influenza, catarrhal inflammation, gram-negative, anaerobic expiration, bacterial bronchitis or atypical cough, Bordetella pertussis, mycoplasma pneumonia, and chlamydia pneumonia. We have SARS, MERS, and have healthcare worker infections and other nosocomial spread. Type 2 alveolar cell, highest, يعني احنا ساعدنا ال AC2 receptors بالنسبة لل COVID attachment in type 2 alveolar cell. This is the highest, bronchial epithelia, tongue and vocal epithelia, upper intestinal epithelium, myocardial cells, kidney proximal tubule cells, bladder urothelial cells. For this, we have the all the symptoms when it's attached to one of these cells. SARS-CoV-2 binds to ACE receptors, depends on enhancement. Antibodies can create a backdoor enhancement for viral replication. Implication on viral replication and vaccines developed. Symptoms, as we all know and we are familiar with, week one fever, is 77% to 89%, intermittent or persistent fatigue, malaise, 11% to 52%, dry cough, 46% to 82%, dyspnea, 3% to 31%. Less common, subcutum, 33%, myalgia, 15%, headache, 13%, sore throat, 14%, diarrhea, 4%, nausea, vomiting, 5%, nasal congestion, 4%, hemoptysis, 1%, week 2, day 6 to 9 of symptoms, 15 to 20% develop severe dyspnea due to viral pneumonia. Hospitalization, supportive care, oxygen, week 2 to 3 of hospitalized patients, 1/3 ultimately need ICU care, with up to half needing intubation, which means 5% of total diagnosed cases need ICU. Can rapidly decline over 12 to 24 hours from mild hypoxia to frank ARDS. Cytokine storm, multi-organ failure. Late stage sudden cardiomyopathies, viral myocarditis, cardiac shock. Comorbidities and risk condition, age, elderly, more risky, hypertension, diabetes, coronary heart disease, hepatitis B, cerebrovascular disease, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, cancer, children and pregnant women seems to be okay. Michel Libet, he said, everything we do before a pandemic will seem alarmistic. Everything we do after will seem inadequate. So defense is very important in these cases. This is the swap, as we know. List of nutraceuticals, which is vitamin D3, vitamin C, zinc, selenium, and acetylcysteine, echinacea. What's about vitamin D3? All of us know the role of vitamin D3 in defense mechanism. First, as the vitamin D receptor is expressed on immune cells, beta cells, T cells, and antigens presenting cells. Second, it plays an important part in innate antimicrobial response, TLR binding leads to an increased expression of both the alpha hydrolase and the VDR, also post vacocytosis. Third, it inhibits monocytes production of inflammatory cytokines such as IL-1, IL-6, IL-8, IL-12, and TNF-alpha, so decrease occurrence of cytokines storm. Fourth, decrease the hypercoagulation state ending with multiple peripheral system disease. This is many lectures and about vitamin D role in COVID. Therapeutic and prognostic role for vitamin D for COVID-19 infections, a systemic review and meta-analysis of 43 observational studies. All these studies show that it's very important to use it as a defense mechanism. Second, vitamin C. Role of vitamin C in COVID-19, as we know, it's also prevents cytokine storms and it's build the lymphocytes and macrophages. Third, zinc. Role of zinc boosts the immune system through stimulation of T and beta cells maturation and thymus support T cells signaling pathway, regulate the immune response through inhibit of NFKB significantly and regulate T cells function to limit the cytokine storm. Third, decrease the activity of angiotensin covalent enzyme 2, which is receptors for SARS-CoV-2. Fourth, protect body cells from oxidative stress relates damage by supporting the actions of zinc-dependent enzymes that act as free radical scavengers. This is also to show the relation of zinc and the pathophysiology. Four, selenium. Role of selenium. Selenium can inhibit NFKB activation, which may help to reduce virus and induce apoptosis and alleviate inflammation and lesion. Fifth, N-acetylcysteine. Its role in COVID.
Doctor, maybe you can summarize.
Yes, I can summarize it. And the sixth one is echinacea, boosts the immune system also, regulate the immune system by boosting the cells action, provide antiviral effect. So, conclusion. Conclusion, formula of echinacea and vitamins and minerals as with zinc, selenium, vitamin C and D are important to modify the course of COVID-19, fast recovery from infection, decrease disease complications like cytokine storms and tissue damage, boost and regulate the immune system. Thank you very much.
Thank you, doctor, for your presentation. Maybe we are on time. So if the audience would like to ask a question to doctor, we can accept the question. Yes, doctor. Dr. Julia Chetinok.
For female, and after the treatment, can we say female gender is more successful? We have a most achievement from that.
Really, there is no special study in this thing, but in our experience, what we met is the female gender, she can cope COVID better than male gender.
How about the age range?
Really, it's all the age, all age group. There is more male complication than female, but only in the pregnancy. We have, and I speak in our country, in our town. We are in Babylon. We have many, many cases, many mortality rate in pregnant women that with COVID.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Now I want to introduce you our next speaker, Professor Naim Ajluni. He is a professor of computer science and software engineering and currently works at Istanbul Atlas University. He has an excellent research background and expertise in computer algorithms, computer security and control, and robotics. Today, his speech will be about, again, the hot topic, artificial intelligence and its contribution to science. Professor, we have 15 minutes for your speech. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And good evening, good morning, and sabah khair. I have the privilege of speaking a little bit of Turkish, so I thought I'd greet all of you with the word good evening. I am honored to be asked to do a presentation for you here today. But before that, I would like to welcome you all to our university. It's a new, but it's actually moving with such speed that we at the university are having difficulty to cope with the achievement and advancement that are happening here at the university. My speech is going to be a little bit maybe boring, since my colleagues, especially Dr. Dahi, he's made an excellent presentation, which is very difficult for anybody to match. Especially we are going to talk about the same thing, artificial intelligence. And I will try and move away from what he was actually talking about and talk about its contribution to different sciences. Because artificial intelligence has been with us for a very, very long time. And it has contributed to many fields and aspects of life. And it's amazing how every day we find that artificial intelligence has made a considerable contribution to one field or another. And it's nice to actually be part of this artificial intelligence journey because it's exciting. We get to do too many things in too many fields. And we feel privileged that we can actually help in the progress of science, in the progress of medical science mainly, because artificial intelligence, as if it was made specially for medical sciences, because the tools which have been developed during the past few years actually just solve many of the, many of the difficult problems that many of the doctors, many of the practicing doctors are having difficulty with. We make their life very simple. We make their life easy to actually increase their accuracy of diagnosis. There, we make their life much easier in executing operations on patients by directing them, as Professor Dahi said, by directing them, by avoiding some obstacles within the human body and to speed up the actual operation time. So let me not waste any more time about this and move on to my presentation. I will not talk about the artificial intelligence and their subsystems because Dr. Dahi done a more comprehensive presentation of that. Now, the current challenges. Now, the world is actually, as we all know, facing many, many challenges. And advancements, real advancements in some of the sciences we haven't seen for a long time. And I mentioned here some of the advances, which was actually incredible at the time they were achieved. There has been improvement on them, but there hasn't been any breakthrough on new sciences in these fields and many others. Now, I was shocked by reading some of the answers which people sometimes make about artificial intelligence. When we ask even students who are studying computer science, what do you know about artificial intelligence? What is artificial intelligence? And we find out some really surprising answers. Most of them, even in the field of computer science, don't know the real definition of artificial intelligence. And they give us all different answers to these questions. However, with business people, a study was actually carried out to find out how artificial intelligence can contribute to their business, or if they actually know what artificial intelligence is. And this study was done for 1,500 senior management business owners. And as you can see, most of them didn't actually know what artificial intelligence is or how it actually affects their business. And that's sad, because artificial intelligence is all around us. We use it, and most of us use it without knowing that we are using artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence is helping progress, as I said earlier. And that's something that we cannot miss, because we see it everywhere, that it's actually contributing to all aspects of life around us. As you can see, there is a number, and there is a lot more that I haven't mentioned, but there is a number of fields that artificial intelligence is making waves, and it's actually contributing quite a lot to, which is finance, national security, healthcare, which all of you here is all about here, trying to find out how we will actually contribute to healthcare, criminal justice, transportation, and smart cities. All these are fields which artificial intelligence is contributing a lot to. If you look at finance, nowadays, most banks will never give you a loan without actually carrying some artificial intelligence search about you to find out whether you are capable of paying your loan, whether you actually have a good financial plan, how you can invest, where you can invest, when you can invest. All this artificial intelligence can help you with. In national security, most countries around the world, and especially the US, they utilize machine learning and artificial intelligence in every aspect of their national security, whether they want to wage a war, the size of the war, the military they're gonna use, the type of equipment they have to use to make it successful. Targeting war is becoming all based on artificial intelligence. Most of the officers, they go through games of war where they can actually simulate a war, how it's going to go, what are the reasons, what are the goals of my enemy, how we are actually going to defend an attack by an enemy. Chinese are actually making this game easy for other people to see how powerful they are. They made some maneuvers around Taiwan and still going. And the Americans, through artificial intelligence, they managed to find out exactly the intention of the Chinese and why they are doing these maneuvers and where the targeting of these maneuvers is happening. All this is being done by artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence makes life simple, fast, and accurate. Criminal justice. Criminology is something that's been mind-blowing for many people. How somebody becomes a criminal? What actually drives them to become criminals? What are the reasons for them to become criminals? Because criminals are not restricted to one sector of people, rich, poor, or educated, uneducated. Anybody can become a criminal. But how do we actually find out in advance who is actually going to be a criminal? Artificial intelligence will help you with that. And in the US, they are actually using artificial intelligence to predict who will be a criminal based on age, drug, being part of some affiliation or affiliated to a group of people who might have relation with terrorism or whatever. All this actually is being used and utilized by artificial intelligence for us to reduce the number of criminals. Because if we know that somebody has the ability or he has the intention of maybe becoming a criminal, we can work on that. Rather than leave them to become criminals, we can work on them maybe in advance to try and avoid them going in that path. The next thing is actually transportation. And this field is now unmanned vehicles is all over us and around us. And you can see this cannot happen without machine learning and artificial intelligence. And for this to happen, we needed advancements in other technology, sensors, actuators, electronics, and computers, programmings and computers processing power. Because artificial intelligence, unmanned vehicle, all this was actually introduced to us early in the 40s, 50s, and 60s. But we were not able to work or achieve anything with artificial intelligence in this field. However, with the advancements after the 2000s, with processing power, memory, space, data, all this become much more easier to apply and to see the results, because applications were there way before the 2000s, but we couldn't see the results. Theories was actually all executed, achieved, proved, the concepts were all proved before 2000. However, now we are seeing the results after 2020. And the last one, which is actually smart cities. Smart cities is something that we need to work on and work very hard to try and achieve, because smart cities will make life much easier. We can save this earth with smart cities. We can all turn green. We can reduce emission. We can reduce the temperature of earth by utilizing smart cities. And in the heart of smart cities, you will have artificial intelligence and machine learning playing a big role there. So I will skip most of this because I have already talked about it. Now, let me just go back to artificial intelligence and healthcare, because I think this is what all of you here are interested in. And as you can see that there has been some implementation utilizing machine learning for health and care and for prediction. The Professor Dahi earlier said that we actually can use artificial intelligence and machine learning for predicting diseases. We can try and help professionals in the medical sectors to speed up because of the speed of prediction that's being carried out, the mathematical speed that some of the machine learning algorithm that can achieve, no human being can actually achieve. And the amount of data that the machine learning can actually go through is something that nobody can go through in real time as machine learning. Therefore, when we come to applying machine learning into medical sectors, a German company is leading some of this research. They have actually produced some algorithm, some application based on machine learning algorithm, where they can actually predict illnesses before they happen in brain cancer, in lungs, in breast cancer, and many other fields, because we want to prevent the illness from happening before it happens. And Professor Rawaf actually said earlier that yes, medicine can cure and will cure, but we need to help them in advance to tell them that somebody might be prone to actually being a cancer patient in a number of years. And if we can actually predict that, then doctors can actually then start early and stop this disease from attacking these people who are prone to being cancerous. And there are a number of improvements that actually been reached in healthcare. And there is, as I said, there is plenty of applications and research that's being done. However, data is the main thing that we require for machine learning and artificial intelligence. There is plenty of data. Professor Tahi said we have to start collecting data. Yes, data is being collected by a number of doctors, and there is a huge amount of data. Unfortunately, this data is not being shared, and that's a big problem. We need to share data. We need to open these repositories, these data repositories, so people can actually carry out experiments, build applications. One of the main reasons that when we are rating machine learning applications in medicine, we say we are looking for high accuracy, something above 95%, because if anything less than 95%, it can be risky because we are talking about human lives. Therefore, how do we collect it? How do we tag this data is very important. And this is something that has to be worked on by engineers and by practicing medical doctors. It cannot be done by engineers by themselves, and it cannot be done by medical doctors by themselves. This is a partnership. It has to be an ongoing partnership where we can actually work together on the data, prepare the data, and then use the data for machine learning algorithm, which at the end will help the doctors, and it will help the people who are receiving the care. This is what's important about artificial intelligence and machine learning. Now, machine learning doesn't come without drawbacks. There is always drawbacks and there is always problem. But the main thing, which is to do with data, the correctness of the data, the accuracy of this data is very, very important. And then security issues and acceptance by regulatory systems, because we don't have yet in many countries any regulation that actually guide scientists and medical practicing doctors on how and when we can apply artificial intelligence and how far we can go with that artificial intelligence. Dr. Dahi said about the UK that if you have a new instrument, the concept of that is being proved by the scientists, by the doctors, by the engineers, by everybody. But you will need to wait 7 years for something like this to be used. That's a shame. We need some rules, some regulations that can speed up this process, so we can have many of the tools that a lot of my colleagues who are working in this field have actually managed to prove and produce for use to try and improve the medical sector. We need to be able to trust our engineers and our scientists who are working together to improve the services that being provided to
people. Could you please summarize?
I will do, my dear, no problem.
Thank you.
In conclusion, artificial intelligence and machine learning will undoubtedly change how we operate in the world. And many of those changes are related to new forms of data collection and analysis. That is very, very important. As more novel data collection, and largely they are collected by Internet of Things, new AI and machine learning initiatives will change how we utilize that data. AI is currently operational in several fields. It is currently introduced in healthcare sector just because of its automated performance. AI is boosting the health sector care section, which is being received by many of people that we know and people that we actually need to serve them betterly or in a better way using machine learning and artificial intelligence. AI is highly feasible technology that reduces human efforts and saves times consumed in performing different healthcare tasks. It is also improves the work accuracy of the healthcare sector. It also has some disadvantages, but they don't provide sufficient reasons for not deploying it in healthcare sectors. I thank you all, and I hope that my presentation can encourage some of the people here to use artificial intelligence and machine learning. Thank you very much and have a nice day. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor. Now I would like to invite our last speaker, Dr. Kayhan Turan. He is a doctor of orthopedics and traumatology and currently a faculty member at Istanbul Atlas University Faculty of Medicine. He is also the president of the Robotic Orthopedic Surgery Association of Turkey. He performed robotic full knee replacement surgery for the first time in Turkey in 2016 and robotic full hip replacement surgery again first time in Turkey in 2018. To date, he has performed more than 1,500 operations with robotic surgery. Dr. Turan, we are listening to you. Again, we have 15 minutes, sir.
Başkan, değerli misafirlerim, gerçekten benden önceki konuşmacılarım alanlarında oldukça ileri gelen hocalarım olduğu için onların konuştuğu yerde konuşmak bana çok büyük bir mutluluk veriyor. Umarım onlar kadar iyi olmayacağımı biliyorum ama yapacağımın en iyisini yapmaya çalışacağım.
دكتور كايان يتشكر حضور جميع الدكاترة اللي قبله أهلا وسهلا بكم جميعا طبعا هو إن شاء الله على أمل يوصل إلى المرحلة اللي أنتم واصلين إليها طبعا أشكركم مرة ثانية
Konuşmamı daha çok ortopedi doktorları için hazırlamıştım ama buraya geldiğimde olayın makro düzeydeki felsefesi anlatılınca ben de konuşmamdan slaytlarımı değiştirdim. Pratikte biz neler yaşıyoruz? Yapay zekayı ve robotik cerrahi uygularken daha çok o şekilde anlatmaya çalışacağım.
طبعا دكتور هو دكتور عظام فحضرنا مواضيع عن العظام. طبعا حنتحدث بشكل عام عن مواضيع الجراحه الروبوتيه للركبه مع الدكتور كامل.
بس تكنولوجيا نيه احتياج duyuyoruz. Ve niye robotik diz cerrahisi yapıyoruz? Çünkü manuelle yaparken bazı sorunlar yaşıyoruz. İstediğimiz şekilde sonuçlara ulaşamıyoruz. İstediğimiz hasta mutluluğunu bulamıyoruz. Bunlar yaklaşık %20 gibi hasta seviyemizde bir mutsuzluk buluyoruz. Bunları gidermek için manuel robotik cerrahiden yararlanmaya çalışıyoruz.
طبعا الدكتور بيقول بالنسبه لموضوع عمليه الجراحه الروبوتيه للركبه هي بالنسبه للعمليه الجراحه الروبوتيه للركبه هي التكنولوجيا الحديثه حاليا بالنسبه للركبه طبعا تقريبا بالمئة 20 من عمليات الركبه نحن نعملها من عن طريق العمليات الروبوتيه بالنسبه للركبه
çalışmalar bize birçok çalışma diz cerrahisinde artroplastide yaptığımız ameliyatların %20 hasta başarısızlığıyla sonuçlandığını, yaklaşık %20 hastada memnuniyet duyduğunu, %60 hastada da tam bir memnuniyet değil, sadece iyiyim ama sıyla birlikte gelen bir konuşmalarımız var.
طب بالنسبه للعمليات الجراحيه للروبوت تقريبا لكن في بالمئة 60 عدم
Biz robotik cerrahiyle dizde protezlerimizi istediğimiz ölçüde, istediğimiz alignment'ta, doğrultuda, dizilimde koymaya çalışıyoruz.
Tamam.
robotik asistif cerrahi, yardımcı cerrahi dememizin nedeni biz robotu buna çok önem veriyorum. Çünkü robotik teknoloji bizim için sadece bir yardımcı araç. Cerrahi yapacak yine cerrahın kendisidir. Her zaman ameliyathanedeki kaptan cerrahtır ama biz robotla cerraha yardımcı olmaya çalışıyoruz.
Tamam, nihna بالنسبه لهي التقنيه اعطيناها اسم عمليه الروبوت المساعد. يعني مهما اشتغل الروبوت بالنهايه الدكتور هو القائد في غرفه العمليات، الموضوع كله بايده، فالدكتور الجراح هو الاساس، الروبوت هو المساعد بالنسبه للدكتور.
Robotlar bize bir şeyi öğretiyor biz cerrahlara. Daha önceden cerrahlar ameliyathanede oldukça kontrolsüzdü. Hiç kimse cerrahı kontrol edemezdi.
Tamam, بالنسبه قبل العمليات كانت من دون روبوت تنعمل. فحاليا مع وجود الروبوت العمليات تنعمل تحت دقه اكثر ووضوح اكثر.
Ama günümüzde dijitalizasyon ekranda sayılar ortaya çıktığı zaman artık doktorlar istedikleri şeyi yapamıyor. Belirli bir sorumluluğu daha üstlerine almak zorunda kalıyorlar.
Tabii باعتبار قديما ما كان في روبوت فدائما تكون المسؤوليه العمليه الكبيره على الدكتور، لكن حاليا بمساعده الروبوت العمليه صارت نتيجتها افضل وفي ضمان اكثر بالنسبه للعمليه.
يعني artık günümüzde doktorları robotlar geri kontrol yapabilmekteler.
طبعا حاليا في الوقت الحالي مع تقدم التكنولوجيا مساعده الروبوت العمليه ناجحه بشكل اكبر بكثير ان شاء الله.
Birçok robot var. Bu robotların çalışma ilkeleri, farklılıkları var. Bunların ayrıntılarına girmeyeceğim bizim ortopedistlerle ilgili olduğu için. Ama ben sizlere söylemek istediğim, siz bir robotla ameliyat, diz ameliyatı yapılmak istediğiniz zaman hastanede aradığınız şey robotun olup olmadığıdır.
Tabii بالنسبه لعمليات روبوت الركبه في كثير تقنيات وانواع من الروبوت، لكن بالنسبه للنقطه المهمه بالموضوع نحن لازم نبحث عن الروبوت المناسب بالنسبه للعمليه.
Ancak robotlar arasında teknoloji tüm teknolojiler iyidir diye bir şey yok. Robotlar arasında oldukça farklılıklar var.
Tabii نحن وقت نبحث عن الروبوت المناسب مو معناته هذا الروبوت افضل من الاخر، لكن نحن نبحث عن الروبوت الانسب للعمليه اللي حنعملها.
Biz bunu uzmanlar olarak bile oldukça zor anlıyoruz.
Tabii نحن كدكاترة عظام حتى اختصاصنا هذا الموضوع صعب جدا تشريح او اختيار الروبوت الانسب للعمليه.
Ancak insanlara gerçekten bu konuda oldukça acımasız davranılıyor ve insanlara robotik cerrahi yapılıyor diye pazarlamayla oldukça yanlış şeyler satılabiliyor.
Tabii للاسف في بعض المرضى يفهموا هذا الموضوع غلط، يفهموا عباره عن تسويق ما الى ذلك، لكن هو عباره عن تقنيه انجح للعمليات الركبه.
Biz robotik cerrahi kullandığımız zaman bunun bize ek getireceği öğrenme için zahmet etmemiz gerekiyor. Ticari olarak, finansal olarak bunu karşılamamız gerekiyor. Cerrahi zamanımızı uzatıyor, enfeksiyonumuzu artırıyor. Ama bunların hepsinin faydası acaba insanların sağlığına gerçekten karşılayacak mı, karşılayamayacak mı? Bunları çok iyi tartmamız gerekiyor.
طبعا بالنسبه لموضوع استخدام الروبوت له مضاعفات، من مضاعفاته هي صعوبه العمليه اكثر، احتمال حدوث التهاب لا سمح الله، الى جانب يرفع السعر المادي بالنسبه للعمليه، لكن هدول كلهم في ايضا طرف ايجابي للموضوع.
روبوتيك جراحي طب alanında gerçekten oldukça hızlı bir şekilde ilerlemekte. Yani yaygınlığı inanılmaz hızla artıyor.
طبعاً بالنسبة لعمليات الروبوت مع تطور التكنولوجيا انتشرت بشكل كبير في الفترة الأخيرة.
Üç dilde bir toplantı izlemiş olacaksınız. Evet, konuşmamızın devamı İngilizce olacak ama şimdiye kadar anlattıklarımı Arapça ve Türkçe bilmeyen, sadece İngilizce bilen kimler var?
maybe we can summarize in English.
Yani çok kişi varsa tekrarlayalım. Sadece İngilizce bilen, Arapça ve Türkçe bilmeyen var mı? Tamam.
Are there anyone who only knows English?
Okay.
Continue in English or slides are English. Okay. Okay. Okay, if you need me, I can answer. Okay, thank you. Sorry? Yes. If there would be an artificial in the robot, yes.
Evet. Robotik yapılan bir araştırmada kişilerin robotlar için daha az komplikasyon, daha az ağrı, daha hızlı iyileşme, daha iyi olduğu konusunda sonuçlar var. Bu da bize robotların artık oldukça pazarlamada ön planda kullanıldığını gösteriyor.
طبعا بالنسبه لعمليات الروبوت الجراحيه هي حسب بحث عام عمل نسبه نجاحها افضل نسبه التعافي اسرع وتفضل اكثر في عمليات الركبه الجراحيه
ortopedi robotik cerrahi 1992'lere dayanmakta ve işte 2015'lerde total kalça ve diz daha sonra da diğer markalarda sahaya girmekte
طبعا مع تقدم الوقت من عام 1992 بدات عمليات الروبوت الجراحيه بدأ التطور إلى عام 2015 عن طريق عمليات الركبة والحوض لعمليات المفصل.
روبوتların bize avantajları implantları doğru yerleştirmemizi sağlıyor. Yani biz implantı femura tibiaya koyarken nasıl kaç dereceyle kaç milimetreyle keseceğimizi bize milimetrik olarak sağlaması en büyük özelliği.
طبعاً الغاية والأفضلية بالنسبة لعمليات الروبوت الجراحية هي وضع المفصل الصناعي في المكان الصحيح عن طريق دقة عالية عن طريق الروبوت.
yapacağımız cerrahın cerrahinin mekanik, kinematik ya da restriktif kinematik dediğimiz farklı yöntemlerle yapılması hiç önemli değil. yaptığımız kesilerin doğruluğunu sağlıyor.
طبعاً عمليات الجراحية هي تخلينا نحن تكون عملية بشكل أفضل بشكل تكون أفضل بشكل أحسن إلى جانب وضع المفصل في المكان الصحيح وما إلى ذلك.
يعني bizim elimizle yapamayacağımız 0.5 nokta milimetrelik bir ölçümü 0.5 derecelik gözümüzle göremeyeceğimiz 0.5 derecelik bir doğrulukla kesilerimizi işlemimizi cerrahimizi yapabiliyoruz.
طبعا أثناء العملية في شغلات ما تشوفها العين المجردة مثلا قياس 0.5 ملم هذا الشيء الروبوت ممكن يعمله بشكل سهل.
Robotların bize her zaman fayda getirmediğini, bazen de zarar getirdiğini, yani teknolojinin bizi zor durumda bıraktığı dönemler de oluyor. Onlarla ilgili kendi tecrübemle ilgili bir şey anlatacağım.
Taban, mağdur olukta teknoloji ve robotlar, müdaimen elhum nokat ijabiye, bu nesil vakit fi nokat selbiye lilasaf lil robot.
Tıpta biliyorsunuz Hipokrat'ta ilk amacımız hiçbir zaman zarar vermemektir.
طبعا في جملة مشهورة للفيلسوف دائما أو غايتنا في الطب عدم إعطاء أي ضرر للمريض.
أما şu anda dünyada kullanılan robotlardan bir tanesinin en fazla kullanılan piyasaya en fazla hakim olan Amerika'da, Almanya'da, İngiltere'de, Türkiye'de dahil her yerde en fazla hakim olan robotun ameliyat öncesi planlamada bilgisayarlı tomografiyle planlama yapmak gerekmektedir.
طبعاً الروبوت الأكثر شهرة حالياً في العالم بشكل عام لابد من وضع مخطط قبل العملية عن طريق عمل صورة طبقي محوري للمريض.
Peki bu yaptığımız planlama bize oldukça kesinlik getiriyor. 0.5 milimetre kalınlıkta kesiyle 0.5 derece hassasiyetle bunu yapabiliyoruz. Peki hastamıza çektiğimiz tomografi bir zarar veriyor mu?
طبعا احنا بعد ما نعمل صوره طبقي محوري هي غايتنا من صوره الطبقي المحوري معرفه وضع المكان المفصل والتشخيص الصحيح لكن احنا بعد ما نعمل الطبقي المحوري هل الطبقي المحوري بحد ذاته له ضرر يعجب
FDA'nin kanserojen olarak sınır verdiği 10 milisievert doz en üst tedavide tanıda verilecek dozdur. Ancak biz bir diz için ameliyat öncesi planlama yaparken hastaya verdiğimiz doz 103 milisiviyerte kadar çıkabilmektedir.
طبعا بالنسبه للمريض او الشخص العادي اكثر من 10 ام اس اف من اشعاع ما لازم ياخذ، لكن احنا وقت نحن وقت عم نبعث المريض يعمل صوره طبقي محوري للاسف اثناء تصوير الصوره عم بياخذ ما يقارب 103 ام اس اف من الاشعاع وهذا شيء مضر للشخص.
يعني biz hastamızın dizini iyileştirirken hastamızı kanser 10 kat daha kanser yapma riskini veriyoruz.
طبعا احنا بينما نحاول اصلاح حقبه المريض عم نصور صوره طبق محوري، اثناء تصوير صوره طبق محوري عم نخلي الخلايا السرطانيه لا سمح الله تزداد عن طريق الاشعاع اللي عم ياخذه عن طريق طبق محوري، فنحن عم بنكون عم نصلح طرف لكن الطرف الاخر في ضرر.
Bunu düşünün, bunu sadece bir diz için yapıyoruz. Diğer dizimiz, kalçamız ve kişilerin hayatı boyunca çektirecekleri akciğer tomografisi, beyin tomografisi veya başka tanılarda alacağı radyasyonlarla kümülatif dozu düşününce gerçekten yaptığımız işlerde teknolojiyi insanlara sunarken, hastalarımıza sunarken bunların zararlarını önce biz kendimiz çok iyi algılamalıyız.
Tabii, نحن أثناء تقديم العلاج للمريض لازم ننتبع هالمعلومات بشكل دقيق. أثناء عم نصور ركبة عم يأخذ ما يقارب 103 من الإشعاع، لكن نفس الوقت رح يصور هو أماكن أخرى في الجسم، ممكن الركبة الأخرى أو الحوض أو الصدر. فهو كل مرة عم يصور عم يأخذ إشعاع، فنحن لازم ننتبع هالموضوع أثناء تقديم العلاج للمريض من ناحية، لكن من ناحية أخرى في ضرر على المريض.
Teknolojinin gelişmesiyle günümüzdeki teknolojilerin kullandığımız gelişmiş teknolojinin şu anda karşılaştırmasında çok dikkatli olmalıyız.
طبعا احنا مع التطور التكنولوجيا لازم نكون دائما منتبهين ودقيقين على الاضرار اللي عم تجي مع التطور.
Biz robotik diz protez cerrahisine ben faydalı olduğuna inanıyorum.
طبعا انا متاكد وواثق انه عمليات الروبوت الجراحيه عم تفيد المريض بشكل كبير.
Ama robotik cerrahiye bazı meslektaşlarımız karşı çıkıyor. Yeniliklere karşı çıkıyorlar.
طبعا لكن في بعض الامور وبعض العوائق بالنسبه لهي العمليات الروبوت الجراحيه.
Diz robotik cerrahisinde bunun nedenini şu şekilde açıklayabilirim. 1992'lerden beri yapılan diz cerrahisinde, robotik cerrahide o dönemde alınan sonuçlarla robotik cerrahi olarak kabul ediyorlar sonuçları ve bunun etkisiz olduğunu söylüyorlar.
طبعا من عام 1992 بدات عمليه الروبوتيه للركبه، عمليه جراحه روبوتيه للركبه، لكن كان للاسف في وقتها تعد عمليات فاشله في هذاك الوقت.
Ancak günümüzdeki yeni nesil robotik cerrahiyle sonuçlarımız gerçekten daha iyidir. Ancak bilimsel sonuçlar, veriler daha henüz 10 yıllık sonuçlar yoktur.
طبعا مع تطور الانواع الروبوتات النتائج افضل بكثير من قبل، لكن مع ذلك هناك في بعض العوائق الموجوده الوقت الحالي.
Yapılan çalışmalar kesin olarak göstermiş ki komponentlerin 5 kat daha kesin doğru şekilde koyulması mümkün.
طبعا مع البحث اللي عملت عمليات الروبوت الجراحيه افضل بخمس مرات من العمليات الجراحيه من دون الروبوت.
Birçok çalışma artık bunun kesinliğini daha hassas olarak protezleri yerleştirdiğimizi göstermekte ve bu artık unikonler kısmi diz protezi daha önce başladığı için robotik cerrahide bunun sonuçları da artık kesin olarak günümüzde açıklanmış ve robotlar artık bizim ortopedi ameliyat alanında yer almaktadır.
طبعا مع تطور العلم حاليا في صار بعض اثباتات وبعض النقاط اللي بتحكي وبتاكد انه عمليات الروبوت الجراحيه هي افضل من عمليات الروبوت العاديه. حيورجينا هون دكتور حاتم.
Bu geniş yapılan araştırmalarda 35 bin dizde yapılan araştırmada gerçekten 3 yıl sonunda sadece robotik cerrahiyle yapılan kısmı dizlerde hiçbir revizyona gitmemesi elle yapılan manuel yapılanlarda %97 gibi bir başarının sağlanması %3 gibi bir revizyona gitmesi anlamlı bir farktır.
Tabii, حسب بحث عمل على 35 ألف مريض عمل عملية المفصل الجراحية تقريبا ما يقارب ال ألف مريض عمل عمليه مفصل مفصل الركبه 13000 منهم كان عمليه روبوتيه والباقي 21000 ونص تقريبا عمليات يدويه للمفصل.
ف söylediğim gibi diz konusunda daha yeterli 10 yıllık sonuçlarımız yoktur. Ama günlük olarak kısa dönemde hastalarımızdan aldığımız izlenimler oldukça başarılı olduğunu göstermekte.
طبعا بالنسبه لعمليه الروبوت الجراحيه مع متابعه المرضى بعد العمليه هذا الشيء بثبت انه العمليات انجح بكثير من العمليات اليدويه.
Robotik cerrahi ilk önce bizde kalça ve dizle girdi. Şimdi omurga cerrahisiyle ve diğer omuz ve tüm cerrahilerde bize ortopedide sağladığı sonuç olarak söyleyebileceğim en doğru şekilde implantlarımızı, vidalarımızı milimetrik olarak yerine doğru koyabilmektir.
Tamam, bizim ameliyat robotiye kebideye kanet fil rikbe ve fil havd fakat halen bedet ameliyat fil zahar ve fil kitif. Tamam, hayli ameliyat abdukhalina nehne حط القطع البلاتين والبراغي بالدقة العالية عن طريق المليمتر.
Pedikül vidası dediğimiz omurgaya vida koyduğumuz zaman omurilik ve hayati damarlar oldukça birbirine yakındır. Bu yakınlıkta olan damarların vida koyarken onların herhangi bir şekilde hasar görmesi hayati sorunlara neden olmaktadır.
طبعا أثناء عمليات الظهر أثناء وضع البراغي الطبية أثناء وضعها عن طريق الروبوت عم بتكون أدق بكثير وأقل خطورة من الوصول إلى النخاع الشوكي وإصابة الضرر فيه.
Ancak ameliyat öncesi yaptığımız planlamayla birlikte oldukça başarılı bir şekilde ameliyatımızı gerçekleştirebilmekteyiz. %100'e yakınlık bir yakınlıkta vidalarımızı istediğimiz gibi omurgaya koyabilmekteyiz ve tekrar vida yanlış koyulmasından kaynaklanan pozisyonlardan kaynaklanan tekrar cerrahileri artık yapmamaktayız.
Tamam, nisbe ameliyat zahar, ameliyat البراغي الطبيه موضوعه في الظهر تقريبا بنسبه 100% عن طريق الروبوت بيتم وضعها في الوضع الصحيح. طبعا هذا مع التخطيط ما قبل العمليه نسبه وضع دقه وضع البرغي في العمليات الروبوتيه ادق بكثير من العمليات الجراحيه العاديه.
Son olarak söyleyeceğim yapay zeka robotlar bize çok fazla fayda vermekte. Ama bunları kullanırken gerçekten hastalarımızın faydasına olduğuna öncelikle kendimiz inanmalıyız.
Tabii robotlar zeki halen عم بتفيدنا كثير بالطب عم تسهلنا الامور لكن قبل ما نستخدم الروبوت الذكي لازم نحن نكون واثقين انه العمليه الروبوتيه حتكون فائده للمريض. رح تكون لها فائده للمريض.
Çok teşekkür ederim.
أشكركم جميعا.
Thank you very much indeed. I have two quick questions. How many more technicians are now, a new technician like engineer, computer scientist, must be with you in the theater or next room? Because this has an implication, important implication on workforce and the type of workforce. Secondly, the Vanchi, was it used? I mean, the Vanchi robotic used in abdominal surgery and prostatic surgery. Is it in use in orthopedics as well?
The orthopedic surgery robot is really very different. And the Da Vinci robot is actually not a robot. It's a jump to move from. There's a different robot which I use to navigate. I'm sorry.
There's a different robot, which I use Navio robotic surgery. We don't need any technician. But another robot, which we use the Mazorix, we need two technicians also.
Can I?
Sorry, yeah. Ali Mali also has a question.
I don't have a question. I have a little bit comments. What's happened? The terminology which is we have to use, sometimes we have to be very careful. Alan Turing, 1945, he discovered AI, but he didn't call it AI, he called it machine learning. 1956, Michael came and he called it artificial intelligence. Now, the word robots or robotics we use here is a little bit questionable. It's not your fault, you're using it, you're the person to use it. But the technology, and I have to announce from here, the word robotics we use here is not correct. We have to call them automated machine. When we say robotics, mean answering Professor Rawaf, it has to do the operation without giving them any instruction. The minute you give instruction, you call that automated machine. So I need to announce here from this university, the word we are using with robotics, not your fault, nobody's fault, it's not correct. The minute to become intelligent and has no intelligence whatsoever, by the way, these robots, because you are the doctor, you tell them what to do. Because you're in advance, you take MRI, basically scan an image, you tell them in advance what to do. And they go and they are very precise because you give them the plan. You give them the, and this is where it is not robots. Robots has to be automated, intelligent, doing the job without getting people involved. And this is basically, I want to record that. That means the word robotics has to change, has to be done automated machines. The minute became intelligent and they do the job without your involvement, then intelligent. Sorry, thank you very much.
Thank you. Actually, we have a robot when it was 1992, it was a robot. We call it active robot. We don't do anything when a robot do surgery. We just put it there and plant and give. It is a robot, but now which we are using, we use it semi-active robot. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you.
No, no. We all auto this using robots. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your presentation. Now we have an online Zoom meeting. We have one more question.
Dr. Akdemir, I am a neurosurgeon. My listen for presentation and robotic surgery different. In my comment, this subject only navigation system. For example, for brain or spine surgery, navigation system, 40 years ago, investment in the medical investment, we use all kind of practice navigation system. Navigation system and robotics in technology are different. And this practice, spinal surgeon, for example, spinal instrument is fixation, lost timing.
Lost timing. And,
surgical timing, very long time. Oil, simple system, on use surgeon, which kind of techniques, the best techniques, this robotic practice and navigation system different. Okay, thank you.
Okay. Dear attendants, thank you very much. Yeah, I would like to give you, but we have a guest in US and he is waiting for 10 minutes. I'm really sorry. After that, we can take the question. Okay, I'd like to introduce you Professor Hector Castro. We will have a Zoom meeting today with him. He is currently working at New York Hospital in the United States, and he is a doctor of internal medicine. Today, he will give us a talk about vascular aging.
Thank you very much for having me participate in this excellent
presentation.
Yes, can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay, great. Thank you very much for having me participate in this excellent hearing of a very important health professionals from around the world. And today I would like to speak about a concept of vascular aging. As we are learning more about medicines and technology is advancing, we're also realizing that there is a big difference between what we call chronological aging, meaning aging based upon your age of when you were born, versus also physiological aging that can sometimes and most of the time influence by how we take care of ourselves and how our health is being managed. Now, when we talk about vascular aging, it is a very important concept because as we all know, the vascular system, the cardiovascular system penetrates every part of our body. And having a very healthy functional cardiovascular system is a paramount for us to be able to maintain our health, prevent diseases, and when necessary, recuperate and heal from diseases. As we all know, when we are young, as we see here, we have a very young, healthy heart. We have a very young, healthy blood vessels that include also the nervous system that deals with the cardiovascular system. We have vessels that are very smooth, that the endothelial lining are very intact, so that we can maximize the flow of blood throughout our body. But when we talk about the aging process, we start to see all these chronic diseases that we all hear about. We hear about ischemia, heart attacks, cardiac arrhythmias. We start seeing issues related to the valve disease in the heart and in the other parts of the body. And most importantly also, we start seeing what we all call atherosclerosis, decrease in perfusion, decrease in the ability to take all the nutrients and remove all the waste products from our body. This vascular aging, as we are learning more and more about it, is actually one of the drivers because the endothelium of the cardiovascular system plays as the most important engine of vascular and total aging throughout our body. When we look at the issues related to the vascular tree, we know that it penetrates every part of our body and then not only delivers blood throughout the whole body, but also returns it back to the central source. But one of the most important things that leads to this vascular aging, just like it leads to aging in the parts of our body, is the oxidative stress that we subject ourselves to in our normal daily lives, in the normal physiological metabolism that we all have. And this redox stress, or oxidative stress, as you want to call it, plays a very integral point in this vascular aging. And the reasons why this is important is because we are starting to realize and we're starting to learn through research that it can be prevented to a very large extent, or at least reduced in the advancement of this vascular aging, because we're learning that as we are healthy and we are minimizing and maintaining homeostasis, that the reduction or the control of this oxidative stress can reduce this pathological state that we call the aging process, not the chronological aging, but the aging process of our human tissues and bodies. And as we are learning that the metabolic processes in our body, as we all know, lead to free radicals, oxidative damage, and that our body has to be able to maintain and repair this damage, it is here where we start realizing that the aging process from a metabolic perspective happens when we're unable to manage this. Now, this aging process has been known to be very important because it is a major contributor to morbidity and mortality. Here in the United States, like many parts of the world, we know that cardiovascular disease is the most common cause of death, second by cancers. But we do know that now this cardiovascular disease process, we just assume that it is a normal process of aging, that hypertension, cardiac ischemia, heart attacks, right, strokes, perfusion problems are very important. But we're realizing that it is the aging process that as a result of uncontrolled hypertension, coronary artery disease, diabetes, obesity, anemia, even respiratory diseases lead to this aging process that accelerates the damage to our vascular tree. We also know that we are learning that the internal parts of the metabolic processes in our bodies are the ones that are contributing to what we call cellular senescence, which is the aging process of the cells. We know that there are a lot of metabolic processes, starting with the 13(1), 13(6), and 13(7) processes that lead to everything from DNA damage, blocking of the ability to detoxify oxidants and free radicals, and more importantly, also not being able to maintain our telomeres in our cells, maintain them healthy. And as a result, leading to what we know is called cellular senescence that then leads directly to not only cellular dysfunction and specifically mitochondrial dysfunction, but more importantly, inflammation. Because we are learning that inflammation, besides being a very important part of our immune system, can, under certain circumstances, be very damaging and detrimental to our overall health. And in the vascular tree, we know that this cellular senescence, as a result of this vascular aging process, leads to the atherosclerosis and leads to all that inflammation that we learn. We all know the process of atherosclerosis, but we realize that a lot of this has to do with the fact that our endothelial cells are becoming senescent, in other words, aging process. And then as a result, this leads to that inflammatory response and decreased endothelial function that leads to all the processes that we all know about atherosclerosis with either muscular hypertrophy or if not cholesterol or calcium deposits. Again, the aging process is one side of it, but then when we look at the premature senescence or what we are talking about today, vascular aging, it is the stressors, it is this inflammation, it is the oxidative and free radicals that induce and accelerate this aging that is a normal part of our chronology, but it can be accelerated because of these chronic diseases. And then leads to what, again, we know is senescence. And then as a result, leads to the age-related diseases. The importance of this is that in most societies, in most countries, we just assume that you're going to have chronic disease, hypertension, diabetes, obesity. But in these studies, we're realizing that it doesn't necessarily have to be this way, that these things are preventable. Studies have come out that are showing that a great deal of cancers, a study just came out of Lancet, that cancers can be prevented if we reduce a lot of lifestyle that are detrimental to our health, smoking, alcohol use, et cetera. And most important, poor nutrition. So what triggers the aging process? What are the mechanisms? Again, not just from a chronological point of view, but from a metabolic point of view, we are learning that oxidative stress plays a very important process, that dysregulation of cellular dysfunction, and more importantly, vascular inflammation, which is what we are terming as vascular aging, leading to this endothelial cellular senescence that then ultimately leads to all the consequences that we as health providers see. Hypertension as a result of arterial stiffening, systolic hypertension, myocardial dysfunction, congestive heart failure, hypertrophy. Now we're learning that these are all parts of an accelerated aging process that can lead to major, major issues. And we are learning that obesity, diabetes, the metabolic syndrome, chronic hypertension, uncontrolled hypertension can all actually accelerate the aging process and are also a consequence of this aging process. So it becomes a vicious cycle. And as a result, we end up having major problems. So when we look at the relationship of cardiac human aging and to health and disease and cardiac diseases, we're starting to see the linking between the fact that chronic diseases can accelerate the aging process, that as we age chronologically, we are more predisposed to chronic diseases, but that we can prevent or minimize this impact. We know that that everything that we all see, increased left ventricular wall thickness, increased left atrial size, decreased cardiovascular reserve, reduced physical activities can all be managed because we are learning the mechanisms by which these things manifest. And then as a result, we see the relationship to all these chronic diseases that we are all used to seeing and managing. So when we look at the issues related to vascular aging, we understand that the oxidative stress plays a very important role. And as a result, we have to then ask ourselves, what are the things that we can do to prevent or reduce the progress? Because as we learn the specifics of this oxidative stress, we learn that there are many things that we can do. Now, in some fields of research, we call it inflammaging, meaning that inflammation is the engine that causes all this aging process. That inflammation or the inflammatory response, when it becomes chronic and pathological, is what's driving this aging process that leads to all these chronic diseases or worsening of the chronic diseases. We're learning how this inflammation deals with all the specific cell sites in our bodies, everything from the astrocytes, microglia, the tau bodies. In some fields, Alzheimer's is considered diabetes type 4 because it's known to be a dysregulation of glucose metabolism at the level of the brain that leads to inflammation. So we know that there are many things that we can do, and studies have shown that through nutrition as being an integral part of this treatment and preventive measures can lead to a reduction in overall inflammation and as a result, reduction or if not improvement in vascular aging. We all hear about the Mediterranean diet, the DASH diet, vegetarian diets, vegan diets, but each one has a very important component that if we integrate all together, studies are showing that they prevent or if not reduce, and in some circumstances, reverse this vascular aging process. Everything from increasing the endothelial function, decreasing the stiffness of the arterial walls, and in addition to increase the cardiac reserve. So when we are now realizing that as technology is advancing, food, nutrition can now become a therapeutic agent. In other words, food can become a drug. Food can be used to reduce, reverse, all these chronic diseases that lead to the vascular aging processes that we all are just used to seeing: hypertension, heart failure, valvular heart disease, strokes, heart attacks, renal failure, peripheral vascular diseases. We are seeing that we can, to a very large extent, reduce this because we are learning how the specific components, the nutraceuticals in the foods, in our diets, have specific targets in our metabolisms that are very important for either causing or preventing this vascular aging.
Excuse me for interrupting. We are out of time. Can you please complete?
Yes, please. Thank you very much. So in essence, when we're learning about vascular aging, we are realizing that it is not a self-fulfilling prophecy. In other words, the aging process, not chronologically, but the aging process is not something that is inevitable. We can control it to a very large extent, and there are medications for it. And we are also learning that besides nutrition, certain medications that we use for other chronic diseases can be used. We are learning that things like metformin and other medications for other chronic diseases have anti-aging capacities. So it's a brand new field. And thank you very much for having me participate in your presentation.
Thank you, dear professor. Maybe we can have one question, if there's any, doctor.
My question is, can we say COVID-19 infections accelerating the cardiovascular aging process? Because we heard we have a lot of reports after COVID-19 infections, coronary artery diseases, heart attacks, and neurovascular diseases. So what do you think about it? Thank you.
That is an excellent point. I happen to be a critical care specialist. And in critical care, we know that the endothelium is the engine for all diseases. And you are absolutely right, and it's an excellent point. Pathology studies have shown that in the plaques of heart attacks, coronary artery plaques, in the center of it, chlamydia has been found. So yes, we know that in the end, infections are going to be one of the major driving forces of a lot of our chronic diseases. So yes, infectious diseases are going to ultimately be found to play a major role. For example, COVID is one of those diseases that are showing us this, because we are seeing that the inflammatory response to the COVID infection is leading to attacks and damage to all our bodies. So yes, you're absolutely right. And that's an excellent statement that you just made.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor, for your presentation.
Thank you very much. And I thank you for having me in this very important conference. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Good evening. Okay, dear attendees, we are closing this keynote session. I would like to thank all of our professors, participants for their valuable presentations. I also would like to thank you all attendees for listening. So now the stage is yours.
All right, so thank you all for your attention. Before we start with the present session, I have a short announcement to make. There is a credit card found on the name of Saad Nashtar. If you are here, we have your credit card. Yeah? So now let's continue with the present session. To give the awards, I would like to welcome Professor Salman Rava to the stage. No credit cards needed. And to receive the awards, I will welcome name by name. So let's start with Dr. Yusuf Algörmüş. Professor Diya Al-Jumeili.
Stay on the stage so we can pass photo all together. Everybody okay. There.
All right. Now, the stage is yours.
So this is your award.
Professor Maitham Dali Yusuf. Professor Mustafa Küçük. And Dr. Nahed Alanmar. Toplu fotoğraf olacak. Okay, to receive the awards, I would like to welcome Dr. Abdulhalim Şenyiğit, Dr. Serdar Elgörmüş, Dr. Saad Badai, Professor Batuhan Özel, Dr. Zaynalabdin Ali, Dr. Aydın Beyatlı, Professor Dr. Birol Akgün. Thank you all very much.
Teşekkür ederim.
So, let's continue. To give the awards, I would like to welcome Professor Mustafa Küçük. And to receive the awards, please welcome Professor Velid Halit, Dr. Kazım El-Musevi, Dr. Rafid Aziz, Dr. Ashwag Abbas Aboud, Dr. Anfal Ali Hussein, Dr. Hadil Jalil Amin, Mrs. Sati Chardici, Dr. Iftihar Al-Dujaili, Dr. Muhammad Emad Kadum, Dr. Risala Hussein Alami, Dr. Salim Muayyad Awash, and finally, Dr. Zahra Khalil Al-Yasir. Also welcome Professor Naim Al-Juni and Dr. Kayan Turan. And also Professor Dr. Engin Gülen. Let's welcome again Serbil Çardıcı.
I wish to thank Professor Maytam Gali Yusuf, especially to work hard to help his health on this conference. I warmly welcome Professor Yusuf, and we keep in touch with Professor Yusuf. Next meeting, next conference, inshallah. I really thank you, all of you, and with my best wishes to you.
Thank you.
So now our last session is for the medals. So to give the awards, I would like to welcome Professor Engin Gülal to the stage. And to receive the awards, please welcome Dr. Risala Hüseyin Alami. Dr. Salah Mehdi Hasan. Dr. Ater Fırat Malik. Dr. Zahra Halim Alkaim. Dr. Mona Altere'yi. Dr. Samar Muayyad Alfadel. Dr. Leyna Atvan. Dr. Hamed Bala Hamza Alsay. Dr. Ahmet Salim Muhammed. Abdul Hüseyin Mohsin. Dr. Lamia Almaliki. Dr. Muhammed Emad Kadhum. Dr. Ban Amer Musa. Dr. Ahmet Cihat Ali. Dr. Maha Hamid Albahrani. Dr. Hamza Muayyad Alfadeyl. Thank you. thank you all for being with us here today. Thank you very much for your participation and collaboration. Hope you have a nice day.